Truly, these moments are not
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together.
O God, you are with us all the holy desires, all the counsels, and all the prayers. Give to us your children, that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments, and all that we be protected from the fear of our enemies, may live in peace and quietness, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
This is what the Lord God showed me. The Lord was standing beside the wall, across with a plumb line, and a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, see, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again have them die. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be made waste. And I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Then Ahaziah, the priest of Bethlehem, sent to King Jeroboam of Israel, saying, Amos has conspired against you in the very center of the house of Israel, for then he is not able to bear all his words. So thus Amos has said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel will go into exile away from his land. And Ahaziah said to him, O seer, go, flee away from the land of Judah. Turn your bed there, and prophesy there, but never again prophesy at Bethel, where it is the Lord King's sanctuary, and it is the temple of the kingdom. Then Amos answered Ahaziah, I am no prophet, you are a prophet's son, but I am a person, and a dresser of sycamore trees. And the Lord took me from following the flock, and the Lord said to me, Go, prophesy to my people Israel. The word of the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Please join me in saying Psalms 55 and 55. I will listen to what the Lord God is saying. For you speak peace to your faithful people, and to those who turn their hearts to you. Let God's love and faithfulness are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Thank you. spirit. This is the flesh, by our ability, for the redemption of God's own people. We pray for this glory. The word of the Lord.
definitely am doing my best. In our gospel lesson for this morning, we encounter Herod, who did not protect their God. In fact, they used her in scandalous and damaging ways. And I'm talking, of course, about Phoebe Herod, his wife Herodias, and their daughter, also named Herodias. Although, in this text, she's named Herodias once, and otherwise, she is referred to in Greek as the word that means little girl. Little girl. The whole story of Herod's heart and his foolish promise, and Herodias' wife, hideous Rosa, and John the Baptizer's murder, all of that is a flashback. It's a flashback in this narrative. Mark is explaining what happened to John after John was arrested way back in chapter 1. We're now in chapter 2. In the flashback, we learn that Herod had thrown himself in a loud birthday party with not only the members of his court, but all the leaders of the region of Galilee. The party was underway when, according to Mark 6, verse 22, his daughter, the rodeo, came in and danced. And she pleased Herod and his guests. So I want to pause here and tell you that there is not agreement among biblical scholars about the nature of this dance. It is a dance between Herod and his guests. So the more common interpretation, kind of the visual that we have, is that the dance was sexual in part, that it was your body, right? And that is why it pleased the lecturer of Herod and particularly the lecturer of guests. Other scholars point out that she was a little girl. And it just says it pleased them. And that that's a lot of interpretation to place on the word pleased. I'm not sure how a drunken king would be so pleased by a child's dance recital that he would promise her in front of all the important men of the region half his kingdom. I'm not sure if it's just an innocent little thing. What do you think? But regardless of the nature of the belief, sexual or not, putting his daughter on display to please grown men, older men who were strangers to her, was not right. Doesn't matter what else it was that was wrong. She was a little girl. At a very young age, perhaps 12, you know, she had already been objectified and sexualized. The message to her was that her value was based on her size, and her way in the world depended on pleasing powerful men. And what her mother did to her was just as bad, and maybe worse. Herodias used her child to exact horrific revenge on John the Baptist by having her daughter make the request for John's head. This girl, little Herodias, she's going to feel forever responsible for his death. That's a lot to put on a child. When the king's soldiers brought the prophet's head, I don't know if you noticed the detail, Mark says they gave it to the girl. They handed it to her. She must have had a nightmare. Well, either Herodias, the mother, lived with guilt and PTSD for the rest of her life, one option, or she learned from her parents. And she grew up believing that the lives of the peasants did not matter. And that their death only served the mission of the politics. maybe someone else. Peter is what? Three Sundays ago, we read the story of Jairus, who came looking for Jesus, desperate to stay in his little world. He was on the verge of death. Mark uses the same word for a little girl, referring to that child, Jairus' daughter, who was about to die, as Mark refers to this little girl in our text today. In the Gospel from 3 Sundays ago, in extreme contrast to today's story, we see a father doing all that he can to protect his daughter, including begging another man for help. And we know that Jesus did go to Jairus' house and raised that little girl from the dead. And these stories, coming in such close proximity to one another in our lectionary, have me thinking about little girls, not only in Scripture, but in our lives, and how God would have us not only protect them, but raise them to value themselves as God values them. How do I know how God wants us to raise our daughters? Because I know how Jesus treated women, the woman who was his mother, the women who followed him and funded his ministry, the women who were there at the cross and there at the tomb for the resurrection. Those women were once little girls. Jesus treated women with respect. He treated them as individuals who had value in and of themselves. Jesus welcomed men into his inner circle, the inner circle of his organization. Mary Magdalene was an equal to the 12 disciples. This is something that the Western Church has forgotten, and the Eastern Church remembers. Translating Jesus' regard for girls and women into today's terms means, among other things, I can't cover it all, but among other things, raising daughters who know that they have the right to set their own boundaries. They have the right to set their own boundaries and to say no. Although, yes, and then we raise our sons to respect those boundaries. And we raise our daughters to know that they are not constricted by the world. We raise our daughters to be kind and generous, but not to be used or to be taken advantage of. And we raise our daughters to know that their bodies, of various shapes and colors, are beautiful and valuable just as they are. And also that our daughters are whole people, not a body only, but intellect and emotion and spirit. And we teach our sons the same. We encourage our daughters to be leaders. We raise them to know what it's called leadership, not boss. We give them strong role models. We mentor them. We don't impose generations upon our daughters. We show them what it's worth. Most of all, we teach our daughters that they are the daughters of God, that they are a gift to us and to the world, that their lives, their will, and wondrous lives are worth all the world. They are God's gift.
One's in the office, Madison, Alexis, I know who you are, but tell me your name.
Paige.
You're not so little, but you're not grown up. You're in between. You what?
No.
If you're comfortable with it, I'm going to ask you to stand. Any little girl, please. You, Paige, Alexis, Madison, you are God's delight. You are the apple of God's eye. You belong belong to God in your baptism. And yet, God respects you too much to ever force you into anything. God will always and only treat you with gentleness and with honor. And God calls you into your own wholeness. You deserve no less from anyone else on the planet. People of God, I'm going to say it again, and this time it's for you. Okay? Former little girls, boys, grown men, you are God's delight. You are the apple of God's eye. You belong to God in your baptism. And yet God respects you too much to ever force you into anything. God will always and only treat you with gentleness and with honor. God calls you into your own wholeness. You deserve no less from anyone else on the planet. Amen.
We have a
tell you just a little bit about the recipients of the four quilts that are here to help us. Members of the congregation are in touch with a foster family who has four teenage boys as foster kids. Wow. First of all, thanks to her and prayers for her. But one of these boys, his mother has recently left his birth mom's. So we're going to give all four of the boys quilts. And that's where these are going. And I invite you to simply join me in prayer. Oh God, you are our maker. You have stitched us together into one from the various pieces of our lives. Now bless these quilts, lovingly made, that they may bring comfort, warmth, and love to the lives of the boys who will receive them. May they know through this gift that you love them. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
We continue with the prayers of the people. Usually you stand. Do you want to sit or do you want to stand? Stand up. Who would you like to stand? Let us come before the triune God in prayer, responding to each petition with the words, hear us and help us. So if I say that we might nurture one another in baptismal life, O God, you will
hear
say,
us. Hear us.
Hear us.
Let us pray. O God, bless the church throughout the world. Uphold bishops, pastors, deacons, chaplains, and leaders of monastic communities. Protect from danger and contagion everyone who attends church camps throughout the summer and provide meaningful worship for the campers. That we might nurture one another in baptismal life, O God.
Hear us and help us.
Bless the earth. Moderate this intense heat. Give shade and breezes to all and send necessary rain to nourish the crops. Preserve farm laborers as they work each day under the sun. That your creation will survive and thrive, O God. Bless the leaders of nations. Crush the might of tyrants. Train those in power to care for all the oppressed in their land. Lead wealthier countries to share the COVID vaccine with poorer nations. Protect whistleblowers and journalists, and form us into persons without prejudice against others. That the nations might know peace and justice, O God.
Yes, help us.
Bless all who live without power or status. Free the poor, especially youths, especially girls and boys, from every form of enslavement. Grant security and self-determination to indigenous peoples around the globe. That all might live in dignity, O God. Bless all who are sick or suffering. Comfort the survivors of disaster or gun violence. Protect us from the Delta variant of the coronavirus. Visit all who are imprisoned and accompany all persons who are facing capital punishment. Gracious God, receive our prayers for loved ones within our community, including Max Benson, who will have a procedure on Thursday, kidney stones, for John Rosick, recovering from a fall, and he wishes very much to return home. For Sandy McConnell, for continued treatment, for Sharon Boshin, in a period of healing, that you would bless her and give her strength. For Elaine Butch, for Michelle Fravada, for Mira Kick, and all in need of healing. For Lori Moser as she grieves Kurt's death. And for all those whom we now name, aloud or in our hearts.
Sage for
Jen, the children of India left orphaned by COVID and children around the world, for the people of Afghanistan, for the people of Haiti, that all people might experience well-being, O God, hear us and help us. We bless you for all who have died in the faith. At the end, fulfill your promise to us of life together in your presence, that we might be gathered up with all the saints in Christ, O God,
hear us.
Receive these prayers, merciful God, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
May the peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share the peace with one another.
Introductions made by him. chance to kind of give a brief narrative so that it's not the same story 47 times around our circle. And I really look forward and hope that you can join us. So 11 to 12, just community time. Noon will be introductions. And then finger foods and things to drink and time to share from 12:30 until. If you have any questions, please get to Michelle in the office or any of the call committee or council members. And we look forward to seeing you there and having a chance for you to meet him as well.
I invite you.
All that we have is a gift from our gracious God. In thanksgiving for what we have received, we give back to God our time, ability, and wealth. Let us pray.
Jesus, bread of life, you have set this table with your very self and have called us to the feast of plenty. Gather with us in some among us and strengthen us in this meal. May us be what we receive here.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.